Audacity, and today we'll be looking beyond the screen, analyzing social media's impact on mental health and global health crisis. Alright, so a little bit about me. Again, my name is... I'm a sophomore at James Lincoln High School here in New York City, California. Talking about some of my personal pursuits or extracurricular activities, I'm a cancer researcher. In fact, I recently collaborated with Harvard University faculty members on a meta-analysis of the anthropomorphic disease. I'm also a mental health advocate, as I'm going to start today's presentation, as well as a lead designer here at the New Public Health Forum, and also an active hospital volunteer and student volunteer photographer. All right, so a brief overview of today's discussion. We're going to start off talking about the background of this presentation. So what exactly are social media and mental health? From there, we'll dive into discussion about the bright side, the positive impacts of social media, seeing how it can foster creativity, expression, and even support among different age groups. From there, we'll analyze the flip side of the coin, talking about the negative influences of social media, particularly how it causes cyberbullying, social comparison, body image, this feeling of fear of missing out or FOMO, as well as how it can lead to addiction and overuse. From there, we'll discuss some mitigation and coping strategies, so talking about digital well-being, media literacy, awareness, education, and really talking about this sort of way forward in the modern world. And then I ask that you guys all hold your questions to the very end for a final Q&A and private section. So with that, let's start talking about what exactly is social media. So social media is generally defined as basically websites and applications that are designed for people to share content quickly, efficiently, and in real time. So this allows for the creation, sharing, and exchange of information and ideas across virtual networks and communities. Some examples of popular social media platforms that most of you are probably familiar with include Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, Snapchat, TikTok, and even LinkedIn. So a quick stat, of the 7 billion world population, nearly 5 billion people are estimated to be social media. It leaves the question if the 2 billion people are just infants and, you know, the super elderly. So now I turn to the audience and ask if any of you guys can raise your hand if you don't have an account on at least one of these platforms.
I have 7.
Yeah. 7. Me too. Almost.
Now, I imagine many of you guys have accounts on definitely multiple of these platforms.
Oh no, 9. I have 9.
Yeah. So it really does show how integrated social media has become in human connection. And regardless of if it's with your family, your friends, your colleagues, your coworkers, it's really become a vital part of our society. So now let's start linking the ideas of social media and mental health. So mental health basically includes your emotional, psychological, and social well-being. So coming back to how we think, how we feel, even how we act. That's determining how we handle stress, relate to others, our empathy, essentially, and how we can also make choices. The effects of social media, of course, on our mental health are profound, multifaceted, and even evidently to some extent. So positive interactions can foster this sort of sense of community and it can really uplift our mood. However, negative experiences can lead to feelings of inadequacy or even anxiety. So let's start off with looking at the positive impacts and influences of social media. Of course, the first thing that comes to mind is connectivity. It's not just a platform for sharing moments, but also a powerful tool for positive change and support. It can bridge distances, bring friends and family closer together in communities where, you know, support and empathy can best thrive. In fact, nearly 80% of teenagers say that placing on social media makes them feel more connected to their friends' lives. And interestingly enough, it's sort of gendered in social media use of teenagers, with girls actually saying they feel a lot better connected to information about their friends' lives and their friends' feelings in social media. That percentage varies from, you know, 40-24% for girls versus 26-60% for boys. Now, of course, going back to this idea of a shared community through hashtags and campaigns, it can also serve as a beacon for awareness and education on critical issues, including mental health. Social media actually has the power to break stigmas and spread knowledge, making it a valuable ally in promoting mental well-being. So, also, social media is a canvas for creativity and expression. It empowers users to share their stories or work and also their innovations, and that offers a sense of belonging and achievement. Nearly 40% of surveyed people actually say that they have a place in society where they can show their greatest side thanks to social media. In fact, 35% of teens say that believe that social media has a positive impact on their lives say that it's because they feel like they have people who can support them in tough times. Basically, people who relate to their experiences. Nearly 28% of people say that it makes them feel more accepted in society. Now, of course, digital expression can also be therapeutic, and that fosters a positive mental health environment. It's through these platforms like Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, Snapchat that we can not only find a place to view content, but also stage to be seen and heard. And that proves that when used mindfully, social media can enhance our mental health in profound ways. Now, I want to put emphasis on the word mindfully, because of course, while social media can be a source of inspiration, connection, and education, it's also important to recognize its dual nature. The very platforms that can allow us to empower ourselves and to express our emotions, really, and find community also harbor challenges that can affect our mental health. So now as we transition to the positive impacts, it's important to analyze and flip side of the point, talking about the negative influences of social media. It's only by understanding both that we can navigate these digital spaces more mindfully, aiming for a healthier balance both in our online and our offline lives. So let's start talking about some of the negative influences of social media. Of course, one of the first ones is cyberbullying. Cyberbullying basically involves the use of digital platforms to harass, threaten, and even embarrass individuals. And unlike traditional bullying, cyberbullying is particularly harmful because it can follow victims everywhere, accessible anytime, and often anonymous, making it even harder to escape. Statistics have actually shown that nearly 37% of young people, essentially adolescents, have experienced cyberbullying, with nearly 30% having experienced it on more than one occasion. And interestingly enough, of the 37%, nearly 25% are actually believed to have themselves engaged in cyberbullying with others. So now I'd like to draw your attention to two particular young women, Amanda Todd and Rebecca Sedgwick, who were eventually driven to suicide because of the harmful effects of cyberbullying. Their stories remind us of the devastating impact that cyberbullying can have, highlighting the urgent need for awareness and preventative measures, as we'll dive into later on in this discussion. Some other negative influences of social media include social comparison and its resulting issues on body image and the sort of fear of missing out. Social media platforms are brimmed with curated highlights and idealized images. People often on social media, they show their lives as seeming better than they actually are in reality. And that leads to unhealthy social comparisons. This can affect one's body image and self-esteem, and that can contribute to anxiety and depression. Studies actually show that nearly 88% of women and 65% of men compare themselves to images on social media, with nearly half of them saying that this comparison is generally unfavorable. Furthermore, nearly 40% of teenagers say that images on social media cause them to worry about their body image, with nearly 15% having developed eating disorders due to worrying about that same body image. Furthermore, the fear of missing out, the sort of FOMO as it's now called, is exacerbated as users constantly compare their real lives to these polished experiences that are shared online. And that leads to a cycle of dissatisfaction and mental distress. And it's that same cycle that actually it contributes to social media addiction, which is a growing concern, especially in studies showing that excessive use of social media can lead to mixed addiction and dependency that's very similar to obesity and substance abuse. Studies show that nearly 210 million people in the US alone are officially addicted to social media, including nearly 40% of individuals aged 18 to 22. And actually, nearly 36% of teenagers agree that they are addicted to social media, that they spend too much time on it. And the Mayo Clinic actually recently conducted a survey in 2022, which showed that nearly 35% of adolescents frequent multiple different social media platforms several times a day. And the most popular ones being YouTube, Instagram, Snapchat, Facebook, and so many more. This compulsive behavior, again, leads to sort of a cycle of addiction and overuse, and that can disrupt sleep, reduce physical activity, and even hinder our real life interactions. So that's why it's so important to highlight the importance of setting boundaries and finding that balance. So talking about balance, let's start talking about some mitigation and coping strategies. So now really what's important to do is to highlight the need to navigate these challenges. As we've seen, social media has a really detrimental impact on mental health. And that can be profound in many different ways, from cyberbullying and negative self-comparison to even the risks of addiction. So acknowledging these challenges is really crucial in taking steps towards a safer and more positive online experience. So of course, this is done through promoting awareness and encouraging open dialogue, as well as fostering sort of digital and media literacy, so that we can better navigate the negative impacts and harness the benefits of social media for a more supportive and healthy online community. So what is digital well-being? Well, digital well-being basically involves the conscious use of technology, ensuring that it adds value rather than detracting. And practices can include a variety of techniques, like setting time limits on certain apps, using device-to-screen phones, and even engaging in digital detoxes. These habits basically help maintain a healthy balance between our online and our offline lives. Also, developing media skills, media literacy skills, enables users to critically evaluate social media content and thus assess its true impact. Coupled with self-recognition strategies such as setting personal boundaries and recognizing certain triggers, individuals can better navigate social media more safely and responsibly. So at this point, I actually want to draw your guys' attention to a specific infographic here, which was taken in the New York Times article. And it shows that nearly 70% of voters actually support teaching students about social media. And that, you know, comes from all different classes of people, mothers, fathers, men, women, even Democrats, Republican, and, you know, independents. So it shows that in a world where almost everything has become so radically politicized, or, you know, depending on which gender group you belong to, this issue of social media and its impact on mental health is really profound. It's being acknowledged by so many different people. So let's start taking action on it. So enhancing mental health awareness and education around social media's risks and benefits plays a vital role in that mitigation. Programs and initiatives that are aimed at educating users, parents, and even educators can actually empower communities to foster safer online environments. So to conclude, while social media presents various challenges to mental health, adopting effective mitigation and coping strategies can actually help us navigate its complexities. And by promoting digital well-being, media literacy, and awareness, we can enjoy the benefits of social media while still safely improving our mental health. So I hope that all of you today will move forward with mindfulness and resilience in your online digital interactions. So with that, I'd like to open the floor to a quick Q&A session.
In your research, did you come up with any regular or recommended number of, you know, on how much time regular teenagers should be spending on social media?
So it's interesting because, again, the amount of time that you spend on social media is very dependent on exactly what purposes you're using it for, whether you're using it for an educational purpose or just to connect with friends and, you know, really interactive sort of social interactions. Many of the articles that I saw had recommended roughly an hour spent each day on social media because that kind of prevents you from going to these more productive websites and accessing harmful content. Of course, it's dependent on yourself and regulation strategies as well.
How much time do you spend on this by yourself?
So, of course, as a student, I do spend a lot of time on YouTube, you know, for educational purposes. So it's a hard question. It does vary from day to day. Of course, for the purposes of the presentation, I should say less than an hour. In reality, it's perhaps a different situation.
You think it is affecting people with personal, you know, family life? Because all the free time they get, they spend on the social media and not with the family?
I definitely think that's one of the biggest issues. Like I said earlier in the presentation, it came back to real life interactions with people face to face. Generally, people online may get so involved in this sort of digital world and that feeling of anonymity, and it's just, you can get mixed up in a completely different personality even. So it's often hard for people to find that transition from their online life to their offline life with their family and friends. Alright, so with that, of course, thank you again to the New York Library and to the Public Health Forum for giving me the chance to present my work. My parents for supporting me in everything, and to previous presenters, as well as Mr. Q for their support and for their very important presentations and their support. Now, of course, this presentation would not be possible without the countless researchers conducting various surveys and studies, the psychologists and therapists who are treating and working with individuals who suffer from mental health issues and disorders from social media, and the public health officials professionals who are working to raise awareness on social media's impact with mental health. So here are my references, if any of you guys are interested in them. And of course, thank you so much, everyone.